That was so out of character for them. I've never known them to do that or to say that. Or maybe the phrase that you use is, what's wrong with them today? These are phrases that we use a lot of times when we're describing someone that's doing something, they're behaving or they're acting out in a manner that is different from what they normally do. It's out of character for them. It's like someone who is normally not bubbly and outgoing, and then all of a sudden they're bubbly and outgoing on a day, and you're going like, what is, you know, like, what has gotten into them? You think that there was ever a time when Jesus did something that was out of character? Now, he did a lot of things that people didn't understand. He did a lot of things that would cause people to go, what in the world is happening? But I'm talking about Jesus doing something that was out of his character. Something he normally wouldn't do. Well, we know that Jesus, or at least most of us believe that Jesus was sinless. So that whatever Jesus does, we know that it's not sinful. But there are some things and some particular passages of Scripture that are a little difficult for us to get our minds around. We're in a study where we're going through the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, and we're looking at the life of Jesus according to Mark. And we find ourselves in Mark chapter 11, and the place that we're at is Jesus is now in Jerusalem, or he's in the area of Jerusalem, and he is going into what is commonly referred to as Passion Week, that last week of the life of Jesus. And the passage of Scripture that we're going to read today, a lot of people, some scholars say that it happened on Tuesday, maybe Monday. That's not really all that important. But it's a difficult passage of Scripture because Jesus is going to do something that is really out of character. It's almost, when we read it, it's a bit of a head scratcher in what he does. So let me set the stage a little bit. Jesus is going into Jerusalem and out of Jerusalem on a daily basis. He's not staying in Jerusalem. He's probably staying with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus in Bethany. It'd be kind of like everything happening on the Strip, but he's staying in Henderson, so he's making the trek back and forth every day. And so he's walking, and this happens. In Mark chapter 11, starting with verse 12. The next day when they went out from Bethany, he was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree with leaves, he went to find out if there was anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And his disciples heard it. Now, if you skip down to verse 20, early in the morning, as they were passing by, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots up. Then Peter remembered and said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered." Now, this is very out of character for Jesus. So he's hungry. He's walking. He sees a fig tree. The fig tree has leaves on it. It doesn't have any figs on it. Now, why doesn't it have any figs on it? It's not the right time of year. This is happening in early spring when the leaves just come out. So the fig tree should not have figs, but somehow Jesus is cursing this tree because it's not producing something that it's not the time of season to produce it. So this is troubling. Another thing that's troubling is Jesus is using his power for his personal vendetta. And he's never done that before. He's destroying something. He's destroying this tree for no apparent reason, no apparent good reason. Jesus had never done that before. And then you throw in this concept that he was expecting something to be there and really didn't have any basis for that expectation. I know that you and I, we expect things all the time and we get disappointed, don't we? But our expectations are just wrong. We have wrong expectations. But here, it seems like Jesus was expecting something to be there, and it wasn't there, and it wasn't even the time of year for it to be. If you do any study on this passage of Scripture, what you'll find from most scholars is they will say that this is the most difficult passage to interpret in the New Testament. It is really hard to get our minds around what is happening here because Jesus has stepped so far out of his character and what he's doing here. Now, let me share with you a little bit about what we do know that's going on that might can help us. One of the things that we know that's going on here is that in Scripture, the Old Testament, especially in the Old Testament, Israel was often referred to as a fig tree. God would make comparisons to Israel to a fig tree. So when Israel was being obedient as a nation and Israel was doing all of the things that, that Israel is supposed to do and worshiping God, there was an abundance of figs and everything was great. When Israel was not being obedient and they were being disobedient and they were turning their back on God, the fig tree would not have any fruit on it. It would have no figs. So there's something here that Jesus is trying to communicate. Something about the disobedience of Israel. Another thing that we know is that Luke and John do not mention this at all. Now, it's not unusual for John not to mention things that are in Mark and in Matthew because he talked about so many other things that were just different from the other three Gospels. But it's very rare for something to just be in Mark and Matthew and not in Luke. And Luke did not mention this. What Luke did mention was he told the parable of a fig tree. And in that fig tree would be very similar to the nation of Israel about being barren and not producing fruit. I just want to say this morning that I don't have any idea what this passage of Scripture means, okay? People way smarter than me that have been studying stuff for a really long time argue about it and can't come to any really set conclusions about what it is. But here is something else that I do know. Jesus is always teaching. He's always teaching. So when we just look at this, while it does present some pretty significant issues, I stopped reading. If you read the part that we read in verse 12, starting in verse 15 through 19 is the cleansing of the temple. Now we're going to talk about the cleansing of the temple next week. And then the next morning, Peter calls out, "Hey, this tree is withered." And then Jesus replies to them in verse 22. He says, "Have faith in God. Truly, I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, 'Be lifted up and thrown into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, everything you pray and ask for, believe that you have received, and it will be yours. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you your wrongdoings." Now, that makes the passage of Scripture even more complicated. Because here we have Jesus saying, whatever you ask in my name, whatever you ask with faith, then you're going to get, even to the point of taking a mountain and throwing it into the oceans. How many people do you know have prayed a mountain into an ocean? I've never met them. Okay? And then you got this verse where he's saying, listen, whatever you ask, you're going to get it. Now, if you're a new Christian or you're new to faith or you're new to reading Scripture and you read this, you go, hey, if whatever I ask, I should get. And then you ask for it and then you don't get it. And that decreases your faith. That doesn't increase your faith. And then at the end of it, he talks about how if you don't forgive others, you won't be forgiven, which totally goes against the gospel because that's works-based. So this is a complicated passage of Scripture that's going on here. So I'm going to try to simplify it for us a little bit and maybe give us some things to think about. I really have two big statements we're going to talk about. The first one is this. Now keep in mind, he goes up to a tree It's got leaves, but it has no fruit. It's a fruit tree. There's a lot of trees that just have leaves, and they're beautiful. But you never go to an aspen grove expecting to have fruit. You expect to hear the wind blow through the leaves and all that, but you don't expect it because they're not fruit trees. A fruit tree is really about good for producing fruit. Here's the first thing. Uselessness invites disaster. Uselessness invites disaster. The tree's pretty. It's got its leaves, but it has no figs. And maybe he's reminding them. Maybe this is part of the parable that's in Luke. And as he's walking by the fig tree, he says, guys, you remember when I told you the parable about the fig and the fig tree and how it's pretty, but it doesn't produce anything. And that's like Israel. But here's another example. There's a lot of pretty, everything looks great on the outside, but in its substance, there's nothing there. Uselessness invites disaster. If you want to accomplish something, you're going to have to work. If you're going to accomplish, if there's something that you really want, you're going to have to work for it. Want is free. I teach that all the time. Want is free. You can want to be in shape. You can want to be out of debt. You can want to have a better marriage. You can want to have better kids. I mean, you can want all day. But until you begin to put into practice some things, until you begin to work on some things, it's not going to matter what you want. And maybe that's part of what Jesus is saying here. Uselessness invites disaster. Maybe he's just reminded again of a tree that doesn't have any fruit. And he's saying, listen, we don't want to be like that. So I want us to look at what does it look like for a Christian to produce fruit? What should your life look like? I'm not talking about where you live or what your job is. That's not what I'm talking about. Well, what should your life look like? Now, I'm going to talk about fruit for a little bit. I'm not talking about your gifts and your talents. Your gifts and your talents are different. Somebody can be gifted and talented and use their gifts and their talents and produce zero fruit. I'm going to talk about the fruit. What does it look like? We're going to look at three passages of Scripture. They're pretty classic passages of Scripture, actually. The first one is in 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13 is known as the love chapter. It gives us a definition for love. It's a tangible thing. Listen to what the Apostle Paul writes. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love is not boastful, is not arrogant, is not rude, is not self-seeking, is not irritable, and does not keep a record of wrongs. Love finds no joy in unrighteousness, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. What is the number one fruit that a Christian should be producing in their life? Love. It is the thing that we're supposed to be about. Well, what does that look like? Well, we have the answer here. Love, in its purest form, is patient and it's kind. So, if someone's describing your life and they're describing you, do they use the words patient and kind? Do they use words like, oh, they're not jealous? They're never arrogant. They're not rude. One of the best ways that you can produce good fruit in your life and the life of the people around you is to not be rude. So much rudeness in the world. So much. Next time you go to Starbucks, you go to Subway, and somebody's waiting on you, and they got their name tag. Why don't you call them by their name? You'll catch them off guard. Be nice. Be pleasant. Is not irritable. Doesn't keep a record of wrongs. What does your life look like? How would someone describe you? How would they describe your attitude? How would they describe how you carry yourself? How would they describe the fruit that you're producing? In Galatians chapter 5, just a few pages over, in Galatians chapter 5, we get this reinforcement of the whole idea of love, starting in verse 13. For you were called to be free, brothers and sisters, only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out, or you will be consumed by one another. Can I say that love is being demonstrated in my life? Will others say love is a word people would use for your life? Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, I say then, walk by the Spirit, and you will certainly not carry out the desires of the flesh, for the flesh desires what is against the Spirit, and the Spirit desires what is against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you don't do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, adultery, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outburst of anger, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. I'm warning you about these things as I warned you before, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now there, Paul is giving a list of what? He's giving a list of bad fruit. He's saying, here's what someone who's not walking with God, here's what their life looks like. They're all involved in all of these kinds of things. This is the stuff that is being produced. And if you, in this passage of Scripture, Paul is not saying that if you commit one of those sins that you're banished from heaven. No, what he's saying is this is your life. If this is how people describe your life, if this is what your life looks like, that day in and day out, month in, month out, year in, year out, decade after decade, this is what describes your life. You don't know God. And the Holy Spirit's not within you. And then the very famous verse that talks about the fruit, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The law is not against such things. So again, what are we doing? We got this really difficult passage of Scripture where Jesus walks up to a tree and he curses it because it doesn't have any figs in it and it's not even fig season. And then, we'll talk about next week, he goes in and makes a whip and cleanses the temple. And then the next day, the disciple Peter notices that the tree has been withered, and then Jesus goes into a talk about prayer. It's a little complicated of what's going on here. Maybe Jesus is trying to show them. Maybe he's calling to their attention. Listen, I know this fig tree is designed to only make figs in the summer. But I'm talking to you. And we are not fig trees. We are people that are supposed to be producing good fruit 24/7, all the time. In 2 Peter chapter 1, Peter gives some skin and some bones to this idea of what does fruit look like in our life. In 2 Peter chapter 1, starting with verse 5, For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith. Now, I want to stop right there. Your faith is at the foundation of everything that you are in your walk with God. It starts with faith. It has to have faith. What God says is that our faith is what pleases Him, so we've got to have faith. You place your faith in Him. But here's what a lot of people do. And a lot of people, churches all over the place, are filled with people who have faith and they don't have anything else. There's no fruit. There's no evidence. You ask them the questions, they get it right on the Sunday school test. Yeah, I believe in God. Yeah, I have a faith in God. I believe Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and rose again on the third day. Yeah, I believe. I got a faith. And that's where it stops. It can't stop there. It has to grow. It has to expand. And here Peter's saying, listen, at the very foundation is our faith. But make every effort to supplement. What's the word supplement mean? It means to add to. What am I going to supplement my faith with? Goodness. Well, what's goodness? Doing good things. Do you really struggle trying to figure out if something's good or not? You don't. You do not. I guarantee you do. You don't sit there and I got to really ponder if this is good or not. What you struggle with and what I struggle with is doing the good. Make every effort to supplement your faith with goodness. Goodness with knowledge. Knowledge with self-control and self-control with endurance. I just want to speak to that word endurance. As we are trying in this walk with God, you must have endurance. You must. Because there's going to be seasons when things don't go right. There's going to be weeks that aren't very good. And you're going to have bad days and you're going to have bad hours. You're not going to come to church and be caught up in the musical worship. And all of this is wonderful. Every week, there's some weeks you just have to fake it. You're not going to open up your Bible and everything's just going to jump out the page at you. And you're just going to say, this is the most amazing Bible reading I ever have. In fact, there's going to be times if you'll take the time to read the Bible, you're going to read it and you're going to close it and go, I give up. But you have to endure. I got to have more than just have faith. I have to endure. And Peter knows this. And as Peter's writing this, he's much older. He's much older. He's gone through a whole lot more life and he understands. And he says, listen, supplement your faith with goodness. Goodness with knowledge. Knowledge with self-control. Self-control with endurance. Endurance with godliness. And godliness with brotherly affection. And brotherly affection with love. And listen to this. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure. So these qualities that we're talking about from Corinthians 13 to these qualities in increasing measure. Well, what does increasing measure mean? What does increasing measure mean? Growing more and more and more. See, there's a lot of Christians that says, yeah, I made a fig once. And I've quit. I made my fig. I got my good fruit. Got my one good fruit. And I'm done. No. Every season. In some seasons it may only be 3 figs. In some seasons it may be 300 figs. And sometimes the fig doesn't taste as good as it's supposed to. You ever notice that with fruit? You buy the grapes and you're like so excited to get the grapes home and you just can't wait to eat the grapes and you pop that grape in your mouth and you go, oh my gosh, what is wrong with this grape? And then you hope that the next one is a standalone grape. Never is. The rest of them are not any good. And then there's those times you bring the grapes home and you get them washed and you pop it in your mouth and then you eat all of the grapes before you even sit down because they're so good. Isn't cantaloupe that way? Those of you who like cantaloupe, sometimes you open up a cantaloupe and you'll eat, you'll take a bite and you'll go, oh, I'm eating this whole thing right now because this is fantastic. And then other times you take a bite and you just kind of slide it over and say, we can throw that away. It's an increasing measure. It's why that endurance thing is so important. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being useless or unfruitful. They will keep you from being useless and unfruitful. Unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The person who lacks these things is blind and short-sighted and has forgotten the cleansing from his past sins. Therefore, brothers and sisters, make every effort to conform your calling and election, because if you do these things, you will never stumble. You want to mess some people up in a church or not church, start talking about how we're supposed to judge people. And I guarantee you, people will let you know their opinion. We are not to judge someone's heart because we can't. But we can judge what they're doing. And you may think, well, that's not right. You shouldn't judge people. Well, if you have a job, I'm going to give you a challenge for the next 6 months. For the next 6 months in your job, I want you to produce nothing. Let's see how long it takes the powers to be to judge you. Are we a fig tree with pretty leaves? No figs? Or are we producing fruit that matters? Now, the second part of this scripture, Jesus goes in and he talks about prayer. And if uselessness invites disaster, then what I see when I read these phrases about prayer from Jesus is that faith matters when I pray. Faith matters when I pray. Let me share four or five things with you really quick. Faith matters when I pray. The first thing is this: when I pray, I must pray in God's will. When I pray, I must pray in God's will. How many of y'all would say, you don't have to answer, but just answer in your mind or your heart, how many of you would say that you believe God has a plan? God has a plan. How many of you believe you can change his mind and his plan because you got a better idea? You're not. You're not. So prayer can't be about telling God your great ideas. Prayer has to be, what is God's will? And when I pray, I must pray in God's will. Now, with that, I would add we need to pray boldly. To pray boldly. Here Jesus is saying, he says, listen, if you'll pray, you can take this mountain and throw it in the ocean. Now, what in the world is Jesus talking about there? There's some kind of hyperbole. There's something going on here. I'm going to show you a picture. This is right outside of Jerusalem. You can see the mountain with kind of little dirt paths on it. Bethany's right over here, to the left. I'm not sure exactly what angle that is. Dead Sea's going to be way deep in the picture over the mountains, and Jerusalem's going to be back over here, kind of that, as you're looking at it, right corner. Bethlehem's right around the corner. These are places where Jesus would have been walking back and forth. Now, on the top of this hill is Herod's palace. Now, Herod has many palaces. Now, there's lots of Herods in the Bible, and I'm talking about Christmas Herod. Okay, you know Christmas Herod? Christmas Herod, at the time, the richest man to live in the world. No question, no scholar will debate that. Some scholars will say he's the richest man to ever have lived. And when I was in Israel a year and a half or so ago, One of the guys, the way he explained it to me was this. It says, Herod, from what we can figure out, Herod owned the internet. Like every time somebody got on the internet, he got like 2 cents in the world. He's wealthy. This is one of his palaces. His palace at Masada is unbelievable. His palace at Caesarea Philippi is unbelievable. But this was his favorite place. In fact, he's buried here. Now I'm going to show you the top of the hill, kind of from a drone. Now, this is a couple of thousand years old. At some point, all of this castle and palace stuff would have been built up on top of that, right? So we'll go back to the, you go back to the picture before that. When you look, it's just kind of, well, it doesn't, you don't even know if anything's up there. And then we go to the next picture. Once you take the hike up there and you realize, okay, there is stuff here. Jesus is walking back and forth with his disciples every day. And maybe Jesus is talking to him about prayer. And as he's walking by that, he points at it and says, if you'll have faith and you'll pray boldly, you can move the mountain. You got to pray boldly. Here's what I'm learning about praying boldly. You got nothing to lose. If you pray boldly and it's within God's will, if you pray boldly and it's not within God's will, you got nothing to lose. Pray boldly. Third thing I'd say about prayer is not for emergencies only. Prayer is not for emergencies only. I'm not saying don't pray if there's an emergency. Monday night, about 11:30, I headed to the emergency room. A couple hours later, found out I had a kidney stone. I'm just telling you, during that 4 hours, I prayed to God, the doctors, the nurses, the wheelchair. I prayed to whatever would listen for that to stop. I'm not saying don't pray in emergencies. I'm saying if the only time you pray is an emergency, that's not going to get it. My prayer is to align my heart with God's. That's why I pray. And then the last one that just seems to jump out the page at me is, again, it's very hard. It's a very hard, difficult passage of Scripture. But it seems like maybe Jesus could be saying, prayer and an unforgiving spirit do not go together. Prayer and an unforgiving spirit do not go together. You want to have your spirit change and your heart change towards someone that you're really having a tough time with? Start praying for them and see what happens. You're supposed to produce fruit. I'm supposed to produce fruit. We're called to produce fruit. We're commanded to produce fruit. And we're created to produce fruit. And like so many things in our walk with God, the question is not what fruit are you producing, but it's what kind of fruit are you producing? Is it things like love and joy and peace and patience and kindness? Or is it yucky stuff? Now, I don't know if you noticed, but the tree was cursed and it died from the roots up. It didn't die from the top down. You cannot produce good fruit if you're not connected to our Savior. You have to be one with Him. It's the only way the fruit is going to be produced. And if you are connected with Him and you're supplementing and we're in it, what will happen? Fruit. Sometimes it's just one fig. Sometimes it's 50 figs. But it will happen. And if it's not happening, something's wrong. Let's pray. Father, it's your truth, not ours. And Father, we know that when we read this, it's a really hard passage of Scripture to understand, to get our minds around. So many things it could be. So Father, maybe as we've looked at it and we've just kind of looked at this whole idea of being a fruit producer, and that we'd be producing the things that matter. Father, would you help us to stop fixing things that don't fix anything? Spirit, would you help us to stop fixing things that don't fix anything? And to begin to do the things that are going to produce the kind of fruit that are going to bring glory and honor to your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.